Roxanne Fontana est née en septembre 1959 à Brooklyn, New York, USA. Elle est parolière, chanteuse, musicienne, écrivain et designer de bijoux et de vêtements, astrologue, beauty school dropout, mère de famille. Philosophe, rebelle, intellectuel, poète, chrétienne. Nous avons rencontré Roxanne Fontana cueillant des figues dans le jardin de la villa d'un ami producteur hollywoodien dans le sud de la France. Roxanne aime les figues. Cela lui rappelle son oncle Tony Gambardella d'Almafi, qui avait un figuier chez lui sur McDonald Avenue à Brooklyn, juste en dessous du métro aérien. Cela lui rappelait son Italie. Roxanne vit désormais en Angleterre avec son mari, le musicien et chanteur Matt Traber, et sa petite fille, Shuki Marie. Chris posa quelques questions à Roxanne sur sa musique, sa carrière, sa vie et son livre, un mémoire rock intitulé American Girl.
By many people to be critical of the USA, yet your name memoir, American Girl. Explain.
Well, a lot of people refer to me as the American girl, you know, where I live. If I'm not living in America, they say, oh, American girl, seriously. And I think that some of the best artists that have come out of America have been people who've been critical of the country and the outcasts of America. When you think of the best American artists, they're always outcasts. They're not the typical American citizen. Yet they become even a person who Americans look up to because they're not like them. So I just thought that, you know, it would fit, you know. And plus there's the song, which I always liked, and I always sort of related to the lyrics of it. And, you know, the Tom Petty song, American Girl. And so I thought this should be the title, you know, of the book, for a few reasons. People like Janis Joplin and Bob Dylan and Jimi Hendrix, they were all quintessentially American, yet most Americans are not like those people, you know? And I've always identified with that and been told that, you know, I'm not typical. So many people in America would say, oh, you don't belong here, you belong in Europe, you know? So this sort of goes into the same area as those people. And since the book is mainly about being an artist, growing up in America and living in America, I thought this is the title. It just works, you know. So that's why I named it American Girl. Okay. Yeah, I know it is sort of bizarre, or maybe it's even a little bit perverse, because I am very critical of the USA, but I still believe in it. I still vote, even though I'm always disappointed. Yeah. But what can you do? You know, you still have to have some hope.
How many songs have you written?
Oh, I stopped counting how many songs I've written in the late 80s. At that time, I was writing a lot of songs. I wrote most of my songs in the 1980s because I was very inspired. I was in my 20s, and the songs were very good, so it would just inspire me to write more, and all different styles, country, rock, blues, poetic, psychedelic stuff, you know. And so I stopped counting them in the mid to late 80s, and I think there was a little over 60 then. But I still write, and I've written a lot of songs with my husband Matt Traber in the past 10 years, and they're really good. I really like them. But yeah, I've written a lot of songs, and I've only recorded maybe 20 of them at the most. Yeah, about 20.
You have been performing in nightclub for 30 years. What do you love about it?
Well, the thing about performing in nightclubs is you really, it's really a personal thing because everybody's right there in front of you. And, but to be honest with you, you know, most of the shows I've done in 30 years, I haven't enjoyed. They've been more of a chore because I'm very sensitive. So if one thing goes wrong, like the sound is bad or somebody said something to me before the show, it's, you know, it has to, for me, it has to be a lot of things all lined up perfectly. People are nice, the audience is good, they're receptive, there's no wall up. And preferably I like to perform with a band. I do a lot of shows just with the acoustic guitar, and I don't really enjoy those that much. I love to play acoustic guitar. I love to play at home and write and play on my own. But as a performance, I prefer to not play any guitar. I prefer just to sing. It's much more fun, and it's easier. So I think I keep playing because I'm still looking to have that high and that rush and that great time that I've actually only gotten on a few handfuls of occasions, because most of the time, I know, you know, I've been told by managers, a real professional is great and ignores all the things that might ignore them, but that might annoy them, but I don't know, I just, you know, you can't help the way you are, and if you're sensitive and something bothers you, it's difficult to really, maybe it's because of the nature of my songs. My songs are very honest and sentimental. So, you know, it's not easy to just become another person and the performer. It's not an easy thing, but I love to play because I love to still be looking for that show that's going to be great. I think of a few shows just in my head that I've done that was such a great charge that it's worth, you know, not having a great show to try to get that to happen again, you know. And that's the honest truth about it.
You stopped a jewelry line in Dublin, and now exactly a clothing line in England. How did this come about?
Oh, well, when I was living in Los Angeles, I was pregnant, and I didn't really have anything to do. So I started getting interested in making antique beaded necklaces. So at my disposal was just so much beautiful beads. So I just kept making them. And before I knew it, I had, like, you know, a lot of necklaces. So I thought, well, let me go and see if any of the boutiques would like to sell them for me. And I learned in New York City, I had a friend that went to the Fashion Institute, and just not serious at all, she taught me how to do the ends and do the, you know, that sort of thing. So I knew the technical aspect of it, of how to do it. And then when I discovered all these beads, I would find people who had trunks of vintage stuff, only vintage and antique. I had one bit where I have these beads that are 1,000 years old, you know, and just making designs with them. And so, you know, the thing is, a lot of people design jewelry. It's a very big field, but almost nobody can sell it. And I just got lucky. I started going to these Beverly Hills boutiques and visiting with the buyers, and they loved it. And they said, we'll take it, you know. And so I sold in all these top shops over there, and they sold for a lot of money too. And I didn't even know, you know, like one place, they gave me a certain amount of money, and then I went back and they were selling one of my beaded necklaces for $300, and I thought, wow, it sold, you know. So I felt really inspired to keep doing it and keep making more. And then there was a shop in Los Angeles that specialized in Afghanistan rugs. It was Afghani family, and they sold some of my things, and they even gave me an antique necklace and said, you go and do this, it's a mess, it's all tangled, so do it, fix it for us, and come up with something. So that was really great. It was really inspiring, but it was mainly because I was pregnant and there was really nothing for me to do. And I just started doing it, like, accidentally, and it became a big hit, you know. So that was great. And with the clothes, it's sort of similar. Living in England, I have a lot of artistic inclinations, you know. Mm-hmm. I'm not just a guitar player, you know. There are people who are like that, and that's fine. But I'm not like that. I love to cook, you know. I have a lot of ambition artistically, and so I went to Coventry University, some technical courses in fashion, and then I started getting ideas, and I didn't think I was going to do anything with it. First I had this idea to make these little tops, so I went to Paris and I bought all these fabrics, and I bought this lace collar to do on all these different fabrics, and so I made 6 of them, and then I made like 5 of each one. So it's like, wow, I'm doing this, but that's it, I'm not going to do anything else. In fact, the very first thing I did was I made my daughter's school uniform. From the lessons that I took, I learned how to do that. I had no idea I was going to go into it further. But now, since then, I've done leather tops, velvet trousers. I made this and designed this, and I've done it in different fabrics. And I just really love it, you know. I love the expression of it, and it's completely not planned, and it's completely not to do it for money at all. It's not as if, oh, I need to do something for money that's interesting and fun, so let me go and do it. It's not even about that, because there's no plans. As of now, I don't have any plans to make anything more, but I bet you I'll have this idea. You know, I did these capes. I did capes with silk lining, and I thought, that's it. After the capes, that's it. And then I got this idea to do these blouses. I started doing the blouses. So I really enjoy it, you know. And I enjoyed just having different things, because if you just have one thing, then, you know, it's sort of boring. I mean, I have friends who just do one thing. And I don't know. That's why I have to have friends who are in different fields. You know, I have friends who are this, that, the other thing. Because I'm not just interested in one thing. I just can't hang out just with musicians. I'd be bored to death if I hung out with only musicians, you know? So it's I don't know, life is short, so you have to get as much out of it as you can.
Yeah. Your memoir, American Girl, ends in 1999. When you met your husband and recorded your first CD, since your life is just eventful. You gave birth at 43 to a disabled child, so your life is completely different than the girl in the book.
Yes, it is. It is completely different than the girl in the book. But it's just crazy. Yeah, it's just as crazy. You know, when you never know what's going to happen next, you know, in your life. But I did the book when I was making the first record, which was very interesting because I was doing music for so many years. And, well, I recorded, but it never was released. And this was with the intention to release it. And it was produced by Dino Danelli, who was the drummer for The Rascals, which is a big group in the 60s, right? And it was funny because I got in touch with him because I wanted him to do something with this one particular song of mine called Spring in Love, because it was a pop song. But it had to have an edge. And every time I did demos of it, I did 3 demos of it, and it just always came out too poppy. And I thought, no, this has to have some sort of like an edge to it, like a blues feeling, like a pop blues, like the Rascals used to do. So I tracked down Dino Danelli to play drums on it. That was the idea I had, and maybe direct it. Tell me what I'm doing wrong. Why am I not getting this groove for this song that I want? And he met me and he listened to the demo and he loved it, and he had this whole other vision, and it was not going to be anything like the 60s. It was going to be electronic, and I didn't like this idea at all. I said, really? And he said, yeah, we're going to do this song. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid of electronic music. We don't want to do what you think you want to do with it. We're going to do something different. So, and I had already started writing the book, so it was interesting to be writing about my past and to still be going through something very heavy that was still connected to the past, because it was me trying to make a record, you know. And then at the end of the record, I met my husband. And that was completely different, because it was the first time that I actually fell for a guy who wasn't a loser, you know, who was not afraid of me. And so that was interesting too, and I was writing the book. And so yeah, the book actually ends where Matt and I first started dating, you know. And yes, since then, things have been completely different because I'm not just this young, single girl all alone being taken advantage of by music business people and by men and, you know, my parents who were always really horrible to me. It's been completely different because I got married to this guy and he's 20 years younger than me, so that's totally unusual also. I never even dated a guy that was that much younger than me. And here I was marrying someone like that. But he's very mature, and he was more mature than people I'd met that were older than me. Men, you know, so it was good. But yeah, then when I had the baby, that was completely different. But in a way, my life is the same because I'm a rebel, and I still smoke marijuana, and I still, so in that way, I'm still the same exact girl as I am in this book. But in the lifestyle of, you know, where I'm coming from, and what I have behind me is different because now I have a daughter who, you know, it's beautiful because she means more to me than anything. You know, she means more to me than the music, and she means more to me than any art and any man has ever meant to me. But in a way, it's not so good because then you have something to live for, which means you can't die. And when you don't have anything, you know, you're really free because you can die and nobody cares, you know, who cares? And once you have that kind of attachment with a child, you can't go anywhere. You have to worry about your health. You have to worry about your money in a way because you have to make sure you have a house to live in. You can't be stuck with nowhere to go, so you go and live with a friend in a room somewhere until whatever happens. Can't do that anymore, really. So it is different in that way, but I'm definitely still the same person. But it's great, you know. Like I said, I love her, and I enjoy to be with her more than I do anything. But yet I still find myself doing this and that. And let's do a show, and let's get in touch with this person, and go to design school, and get fabric. And then I'm not really with her because I'm doing all these other things. But she's number one to me, you know. So it was a good change to have her in my life. Yeah.
Golden Queen of Cups. Pour moi, mon A chill to feel the rain.